السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer, the one in whose hands lies the control of every single aspect of existence. وأصلي وأسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين نبينا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا وإمامنا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them all without exception. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us and our offspring, those to come up to the end of time. May Allah keep us all steadfast and may He grant us paradise. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, I have a smile on my face. And the reason is, I am so touched. I have many friends in Guyana. Some of them I met in Medina Munawwara when I was studying. And subhanallah, some of them are no longer in this beautiful country. They have shifted to other countries. But I've always wanted to know, where is this place and what is it all about? And this evening I can comfortably tell you that I feel like I'm a part of the family here. When I see these large numbers, really I only feel the love. And this is why I want to start off by saying, my brothers and sisters, I am here with a message of love, not a message of hate. I am here with a message of peace, not a message of war. I'm here with a message of tolerance, not a message of intolerance. And I want you to open your hearts and to listen to what I'm about to say, because I come from very, very far away. And the reason I'm here is only and solely to be able to motivate myself and yourselves to do something good in a way that we get closer to the Almighty. And in a way that on the Day of Judgment, when we leave this world and we face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will have a few deeds that we hope and pray through the mercy of Allah, He will look at and He will give us paradise. Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, we speak about love, not about hatred. Today, mashallah, you are here. I think it is a very large crowd. You would agree that some of us don't even know each other. I want you to take the moment or a few moments before you leave this evening to greet at least five people you don't know. To greet them and to smile at them. Don't ask questions that will embarrass them. And we've had this in the past where I've told people in a masjid to greet each other. And later on one brother came to me and told me, this guy's asking me, Salaamu Alaikum wa Alaikum As-Salaam, where do you work, what's your salary, what's happening, you know. Would you give me a discount if I came to buy things by you and so on? That defeats the purpose. We just want to greet. Assalamu alaikum means may peace be upon you. Do you know, if you analyze that statement, it is an act of worship. Assalamu is all the different aspects of peace. May all the different aspects of peace be upon you. That is a prayer that I am asking the Almighty to bless you with. When I see you, I am saying, peace be upon you. What did I say at the beginning? I am here with a message of peace, not with a message of war. We don't say, Al-Harbu Alaykum. You know, may war be upon you. Not at all. May peace be upon you. So, when you say that, you are taught not to be hypocritical. The hypocrite is the one who says, peace be upon you, and has a broad smile, and as soon as we turn our backs, the daggers come out. The statements come out that are bad, that are evil. What's the point of such people? I'd rather have someone who tells me to my face what he or she feels than a person behind my back stabbing me and yet on my face smiling as though they are showing me their $1 million smile. I hope they are not dentures. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. With all due respect to those who have dentures, you know what I mean. My brothers and sisters, if you take a look at that beautiful greeting of Islam, you are saying, may the peace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon you. May peace be upon you. And the hadith speaks about how important it is to greet one another. The verses of the Quran relate to us how important it is to respond to the greeting, because when someone does something good to you, you need to do something good to them in return. Why is it that we are taught as Muslims that it is highly recommended to greet, right? From the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَمْرٍ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَبْتُمْ أَفْشُ السَّلَامَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Should I not show you something, if you were to do it, it would spread a lot of love between you. He says, spread the salam among you. What is the salam? Primarily the greeting, but the genuine greeting, not the fake greeting. When we say the genuine greeting, what we mean is, when I say peace be upon you, I am the first person who will ensure that from me there is a lot of peace that comes in your direction, never harm. Subhanallah. If I were to say may peace be upon you, in a nutshell, I am telling you, I guarantee you that to begin with, I will not harm you. And on top of that, if others are trying to harm you, I guarantee you that I will come to defend you. How many of us really say assalamu alaikum in that sense? Very few. Now when you say assalamu alaikum, say it clearly. The problem with us, we've abbreviated it to SLM. I wonder what that means. SLM, have you seen it? And then when we see each other, we say salam, and that's it, it's over. Greet correctly, assalamu alaikum, it's an act of worship. You receive rewards for that. Do you know that? And you are saying, I guarantee you I won't harm you, and if someone else tries to harm you, I guarantee you that I will try my best to defend you. Subhanallah. If the Muslims really and truly happen to say that, and they happen to mean it, we would only be spreading love and peace on earth. This is why that narration says, should I not show you something, if you were to spread it amongst you, it would increase the love among you, and that is assalamu alaykum. And it is in fact salam from all aspects, starting with this salutation. However, the greeting, to initiate it, it's recommended in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But to reply to it is compulsory. It's mentioned in the Quran. وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُمْ بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَسِيبًا. When you are greeted with a greeting, when you are greeted with a greeting, Allah says, so respond to it with a better greeting. Wow. When you are greeted with a greeting, respond to it with a better greeting. Imagine, Islam is teaching you the basics, talking about greeting and the importance given to greeting. It goes to show you that if you were to give your high fives and low fives, it may not help you. But if you were to say, assalamu alaikum, it's higher than 10 of those high fives. You mean it. Allah says, if you were to be greeted with a greeting, respond with a better greeting. Or if you cannot do that because the person has greeted you with a very high level of greeting, then at least respond to it equally. So if someone says assalamu alaikum, it means may peace be upon you, and I've explained to you the details of it. And if someone says wa rahmatullahi, it means and I pray that the mercy of Allah descends upon you as well. That's the meaning of wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I pray may peace be upon you and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa barakatuh. Barakatuhu means, and I pray that the blessings of Allah be showered upon you. Wow, what a greeting. I pray that the peace be upon you. I pray that the mercy of Allah be upon you. And I pray that Allah shower His blessings upon you. You should be gobsmacked. Wow. I love you, man. Is that your prayer for me? The problem is a lot of us are not even genuine. Just like after salah, we say astaghfirullah. And so many times we say astaghfirullah. It's supposed to mean, oh Allah, I seek your forgiveness. But many of us don't even know what we've said because we are paying lip service to it without even concentrating. I call upon you to concentrate. When you say astaghfirullah, think for a moment, what am I saying? I'm saying, oh Allah, forgive me. Sometimes say it in a language you understand, because it might be more powerful for you to concentrate upon. But also utter the Arabic, because definitely that is the exact wording that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has uttered, the messenger may peace be upon him. So Imagine if we were to concentrate on this greeting and say, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm going to say it in English because, like I told you moments ago, it will have a greater impact because we don't even know the Arabic language at times. And even if we know the meaning of it, we don't think about it when we utter these words. It means may the peace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon you from all angles. And may the mercy of Allah be upon you. And may His blessings be showered upon you. Wow, subhanallah. And you reply to say, and may the peace be upon you too. And the mercy of Allah be upon you too. And may He shower His blessings upon you too. Wow. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And you respond, wa alaykum assalamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Tell me genuinely, my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, I want to ask you a question. If you were genuine in your greetings and the others were genuine in their replies, and if you were genuine in your responses to those who greeted you in this particular way, surely we would have a lot of love and not hatred in the ummah. We would have a lot of peace and not war. We would have a lot of tolerance and not intolerance. We would have people who got along, who coexisted, and not people who did not coexist at all. Today, we are fragmented as an ummah. Don't you agree? Across the globe, we are suffering. We have small differences. Literally, the way I blink my eye is different from the way you blink your eye. So I'm a person you should not even look at. If I were to be dying and a dog was dying next to me, you save the dog but you leave me, because I blink my eye in a different way. That's where we've got to as an ummah. And this is the reason why I am here in Guyana, to spread a message to you, to tell you, do not allow that to happen to you. Because if you would like to save the entire ummah, and if you would like to serve humanity by spreading the good message to humanity, you need to rise above all of these petties, and you need to start using your brain together with your heart, together with the instruction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let people contaminate you to make you hate one another, because the Messenger, peace be upon him, helped us. He guided us to love one another. He tells us how important it is to feel for one another. He tells us how important it is to correct one another in a beautiful way. If I have a difference with you, I need to first ask myself, is this difference permissible? Is it okay? If it is fine, leave it. We will always be different. How many of you here are married? You love your spouse, you love your children, you love your parents, but you have so many differences with them. Did that make you say, I hate my wife, I hate my husband, I hate my children, I hate my parents or my relatives? No, you know you have differences, but you try and live with those differences in a way that perhaps you may discuss them. You may want to try and get together, seeing eye to eye on matters of importance. And as for matters that are not extremely important, let them be. She likes a pizza, I don't eat pizza at all. That doesn't mean I must divorce her. Alhamdulillah, I can enjoy whatever I am eating and she can enjoy whatever she is. The idea is both of us have ordered from the same menu at the restaurant. They have an option, don't they? When you see the menu at a restaurant, they will offer you burgers, they will offer you grilled chicken perhaps, they will offer you, you know, so many different things, and you choose what you want, she will choose what she wants, your children may choose what they want. They may not like what you took, and you may not like what they have, but at the same time, it's the same menu, and you have both eaten, you have filled your bellies, you love one another, you thank Allah for it, you're still part and parcel of the same family. The same applies in the ummah. Sometimes we will have differences, and we always need to be open to this fact. Because from the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were differences among the companions radiyallahu anhum. There was once an occasion where the Prophet, peace be upon him, issued an instruction regarding Banu Qurayza. They had just come back from the battle of Ahzab, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed them. He said, لا يصلين أحدكم العصر إلا في بني قريضة. He instructed them saying, none of you should read your Salatul Asr until you get to Banu Qurayza, the outskirts of Medina, where the Jewish clan was. So it was almost the time for Asr, and in fact close on to the time of Maghrib, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum rushed towards Banu Qurayza because they wanted to adopt the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, at a certain point that the sun began to set, And so the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the companions were divided into two groups. What happened? One group says, let us fulfill our asr before the time of Maghrib comes in and we are here going to Banu Qurayza. The other group says, how can you do that? Didn't you hear that the instruction for today's asr is connected to a place and not a time? Because if the Prophet ﷺ said, do not read your asr until you get to Banu Qurayza, it means today it's got nothing to do with the time, it's got to do with the place. And the first group says, no, all he meant was rush there. He didn't mean it literally exactly as you took it. So there was difference of opinion. Among who? The companions. And the time for asr was about to expire. So some of them decided, no problem, we will read it. Those of you who feel otherwise, you may proceed. They didn't start shooting each other and calling each other names and executing each other and becoming intolerant. Not at all. They were understanding the statement of the same messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One group understood that he meant rush to Banu Qurayza. So it was a way of emphasizing that. And the other group understood that he meant you're not allowed at all to fulfill Salatul Asr even if the time is expiring. You must first go to Banu Qurayza and then you must read Asr there. So when they got to Banu Qurayza, they stopped, they paused for a moment and they were reading Salatul Asr. As they completed their Salatul Asr, the group that decided to read Salatul Asr earlier in the way, they arrived. So the amount of time that was displaced was exactly the same. It's only the place that they did it was different. When they got to Banu Qurayza, ultimately they were together because one group spent a certain amount of minutes while they were on the road, on the path to read Salatul Asr. The others, they arrived there and they spent the same amount reading Salatul Asr. When they finished, this group had just arrived. Do you understand? So there was no real difference as such. When they asked the Prophet, peace be upon him, regarding a pillar of Islam, Salah, one group is saying, do not read it now, let it expire in according to time, but according to place, we will be okay. And the other group is saying, you're not allowed to let this Salah expire because it's a pillar of Islam. And it's the most important pillar of Islam. So we will read it here and now. They allowed each other to be different in that. They went to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked him about it. And he nodded his head for both, teaching them that both opinions were correct because the idea was following the instruction of the Messenger, although the understanding was slightly different. My brothers and sisters, for me, we need to spread this type of hadith and these type of incidents in the world today. Because sadly, when people are preaching religion, they become such that it is only my opinion and that's the only opinion. The rest of the people are going to hell. To be honest with you, if you say they are going to hell, they say you are going to hell, the others say both of you are going to hell, and a fourth party says all three of you are going to hell, why did Allah create heaven? Why did Allah create heaven? Who's going to go there? So it's better for you to start letting people be granted entry into Jannah. Make dua for that, pray for that, because Jannah doesn't belong to me or you. It belongs to Allah. He is the one who is the owner of the Day of Judgment. We say it so many times. Maliki yawmin deen. Owner of the Day of Judgment. We've said it so many times. We've lost count. But sometimes we tend to judge people and doom them to heaven and hell. Doom them to hell and sometimes grant them heaven as though it belongs to us. May Allah protect us. Religion is something very delicate. Remember, it is our duty to encourage people. I am here to encourage you, not to discourage you. When the Prophet, peace be upon him, who was the best of creation, sent two of his comrades to Yemen. Who were they? His companions. Radiallahu anhum, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, very knowledgeable, radiallahu anhu, companion. And the other one was a man known as Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, radiallahu anhu. Powerful individuals. They were mountains of knowledge. The Prophet says, go to Yemen, go to this region, go to a certain place and teach the people Islam. And then what did he say? His parting advice was as follows, Bashira wa la tunaffira. Give them good news. Give them good news. Encourage them. Don't make them turn away. Don't discourage them. Don't give them bad news. Some people get up and they say, guys, you're all going to Jahannam. You know why? Look at the way you're seated. You're all going to hellfire. Look, you know why? Because you're wearing all different colors. You're all going to hellfire. Do you know why? Because you forgot to say Bismillah before you sat on your seat. And so on. Hellfire, 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 whole day. Relax. Speak about paradise. We want to go there. Perhaps you'll encourage people to get there. Perhaps you'll encourage people to do good deeds. Who knows, the person who might be, and I've given this example in the past, I'd like to give it again, mashallah. I was picked up from the airport in Guyana by a vehicle I never expected to be picked up in. I was expecting a Toyota Corolla like mine, 1996 and so on. You know, alhamdulillah, and we'll jump in and get to the city boy, you know. But at the same time, guess what happened? There was a state-of-the-art motor vehicle. Mashallah, may Allah bless the organizers. They probably wanted comfort for us. The sheikhs didn't ask for the Rolls Royce. It came on its own. Subhanallah. We didn't ask for it. Don't think that people came to you and they demanded, we want this and we want that. No, no, no. Relax. Take it easy. Clean your heart. Think good. Tell yourself, mashallah. You know, if a pop star was coming from the USA, the public would pay $1,000 to have a VIP seat. Do you know that? Alhamdulillah, we're not pop stars. But should I tell you, the message we have is a real message. So stop contaminating your heart to think why this and why that. No, no, no. But when the vehicle came in, I'm thinking to myself, subhanallah, look at this car. And these people are so, so dedicated. They have spent time, effort, energy, resources, wealth, money, you name it, it's happened. Look at the success of this function. Don't let yourself go back from tonight and say a single negative word. Create a positive vibe about what has happened tonight. We want to live with each other as Muslimin, even coexist with those who are not Muslim, because a lot of us seated here were not Muslim before, or our fathers or forefathers. It is the concern of someone who was a good Muslim to have come and spread the beautiful message which made our forefathers enter the fold of Islam in a way that today we are seated here in the thousands. Alhamdulillah, may Allah bless them all. Wouldn't you want someone 10 generations down to make a dua for blessings for you? If you would, then start working hard on those who are not Muslim, those who might not be on the straightest of paths, without feeling that you are the one who's going to die on the straight path because you don't know. You need to keep trying until that point. Some people are perhaps not on the straightest of paths right now, but before they die, they would be on the straightest path. And there are others on a straight path. Before they die, they might just slip and miss a turn. Subhanallah. We have a Garmin, a GPS, we have a TomTom or navigation. You know the navigational systems. You punch in your destination, for example, Jannah. What happens? It will tell you, it will calculate the way, it will tell you how long it will take you to get there. It might even give you the traffic nowadays, and you follow this path. And you follow it no matter what. A lot of us who use this, I use it in countries that I don't know. I like to drive on my own a lot of the time, so I use a TomTom. And I just know I've got to follow this thing, no matter what. It takes you through the ghettos and the slums. You get scared sometimes. You look at people giving you these dirty looks, but you just follow. It says, continue straight. Doesn't it say that? It says, in 150 meters, prepare to turn right. And what happens? You slow down and you prepare to turn right. And if by mistake you turn left, it says, when possible, make a U-turn. Allahu Akbar. Have you heard that? When possible, make a U-turn. I am here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, when possible, make a U-turn. I am here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, when possible, make a U-turn. If you have hit left instead of right, when possible, make a U-turn. Can I tell you what happens? Our system is so sophisticated with these highways that if you were to make a wrong turn, before you come back onto the right path, you might have used half of your gas. Do you agree? You might have already be now worried that, hey, already so much of time is gone. I was 20 kilometers away from my destination. Now that I hit a bad turn, it says 35 kilometers. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. And then you have to make a plan, and sometimes you stop. You put your car in reverse and you're watching. There's no traffic police looking at me. I need to reverse on the highway. Illegal. But guess what? If that's going to take you onto the path quickly, my brothers and sisters, when we talk of religion, we cannot say delay. We've got to say here and now. Tonight you have an opportunity. This is why I say open your hearts. Listen to the message. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Mu'adh ibn Jabal and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhuma, he says, give good news, don't give bad news when you talk to the people. Yassira wa la tu'assira. Make things easy for them. Don't make them difficult for them. Imagine the messenger is telling his companions, you're going to go to teach people Islam. Make things easy for them, not difficult. Give them good news, not bad news. Yassira wa la tu'assira. Wabashira wa la tunaffira. Subhanallah. What about us? When we talk to our brothers and sisters, we sometimes doom them. My brothers and sisters, yes, there is hellfire. We know about it. We will speak about it from time to time. But the globe out there is so depressing that I believe today we need to speak a lot about hope in the mercy of Allah. A lot of us are losing hope. We're losing hope because we're struggling and we see our brothers and sisters across the globe struggling, and everyone knows the reasons for their struggle. Sometimes there's very little that we can do about it, but the minimum is pray for them, reach out to them, try and help out. Whenever it comes to a helping hand, you should be in the forefront. This is what the Ummah is all about. This is what humanity is all about. And it doesn't mean that only when the Muslims are struggling that you will reach out to help them. Even when the non-Muslims are affected, you reach out to help them and see what happens. They will change their perception of Islam. You and I know that the media is on a campaign trying to distort the image of Islam, whereas we who are Muslims and those who are educated from among the non-Muslims know that Islam preaches peace, promotes tolerance, promotes coexistence, promotes the fulfilling of rights on either side. May Allah keep us steadfast. My brothers and sisters, it's very important for us to lead a balanced life. Do not try and solve a problem in a way that creates another 10 problems. The difficulty with us, we are spontaneous. We don't think sometimes. We want to solve a problem in a way that we are now sitting with another 10 problems. Like I said earlier, imagine if our forefathers were killed because they were not Muslim, what would have happened to us? This is an ideology that people are spreading today to say non-Muslims, just kill them off. Astaghfirullah, where did you get that from? We've been in existence for over 4 decades. I'm talking of myself, okay, that's a quick way of giving my age away. But at the same time, a lot of us would understand who've been living for decades and seen our parents and so many who have been Muslimin. We've been living in a beautiful way. The number of Muslimin is increasing. And the attitude is not the attitude of just killing people simply because you differ with them. No, reach out to them. If you're intelligent enough, you'll be able to convince them. And if you're wrong, who knows, they might be able to teach you a thing or two. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May He unite us. We speak about unity, unity. The problem is we've mistaken it for uniformity. There's a big difference between the two. Uniformity and unity are two totally different things. If you are talking about uniformity, you're never going to achieve it, because that means everything and everyone must be exactly the same. You won't have that. I might like orange juice and you might like mango, and the other person might like the berry juice. In fact, I've changed my mind. The cherry juice we had at Brother Ashraf's place was not bad. MashaAllah. So that's my favorite now. Now what happens? So we don't like each other. We don't like each other. No. Why? Because you're an orange man. These are the labels we attach to each other. Orange man, cherry man, banana man, so man, this man, and Zimbabwe man. And with these labels, we actually begin to hate each other. So much so that even the goodness from one another we don't see. And yet the bulk of what happens is good. Subhanallah. I know of a school teacher who was a Muslim lady, and she didn't dress appropriately in the sense that she used to wear a skirt and not cover her hair, but she was a powerful, beautiful mathematics teacher. Dedicated, she achieved. She taught so many of the children mathematics until one man comes up and starts saying, you know what, ma'am, I'm sorry to say, no matter what, you are going to hell. How can you say that? Are you Allah? You know, when they told me that, I said, maybe he is the gatekeeper of hell. Astaghfirullah. And obviously I was saying it in a sarcastic way. How can you doom a person? If you are really concerned, reach out to them with character and conduct. And this sister actually became so annoyed that she decided to seek help, because she said, if this is the attitude of the Muslims, it's so difficult to even be associated with them in any way. The little bit that she used to do was hidden. Why discourage her? But if you wanted to encourage her, you could have done it in different ways. You could acknowledge the good that she is perhaps teaching the people in terms of mathematics and so on, and drop in a word or two, perhaps give a disc or two. You know, I normally say a lot of us are embarrassed to preach the goodness of Islam to the non-Muslims, because by the time we say, you know, I feel my faith is correct, they say you're a bigot. Well, everyone feels their faith is correct. The Christians feel they are correct. The Jews feel they are correct. The Hindus feel they are correct. The Buddhists feel they are correct. And the Muslims feel they are correct. Each one will be given, in a country of this nature, the right to believe whatever they want, and at the same time to preach it. You're allowed to preach it, communicate it, discuss it, maybe even debate it. Nothing wrong. But when you lack brains, when you lack intellect, when you lack the knowledge of Islam as well, you become impatient. If Allah wanted, He could have told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the age of 62 that, listen, we are now making you a prophet and we're giving you 15 minutes with these guys and another 20 minutes with these guys, and that's it. After that, we're taking you away. It would have been okay. He would have come and given his message in 15 minutes. Listen, this is what it is. I'm leaving this Quran with you. It's from Allah and I'm going. That would have been okay if Allah chose that, but He didn't. Allah says, we want you to stay with them for 23 years. And we want those to follow, to know that even while you were there, there were people who didn't accept the message. And there were people who lived in Medina and Mecca as non-Muslims. And they were treated fairly. And they were treated in accordance with rules and regulations that fulfilled their rights, and they fulfilled the rights of the others. And it was 23 years, so many people actually denied the message. But today what has happened? Because of that beauty, because of that tolerance, because of that beautiful method, because of giving people good news, today we have almost 2 billion Muslims on the globe. Let's learn from this. My brothers and sisters, I told you, let's greet a few people, at least 5, while going out, of those whom you don't know. And I don't mean the youngsters should now go and greet 5 little girls they don't know. No. You know what I mean. Salaamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. How are you, my sister? Oh, so good to see you. Stop there. Alhamdulillah. If you really want, mashallah, you will notice that face another time somewhere else. And you'll say, oh, mashallah, I saw you. Where did I see you? You remember the function we had? Yeah, mashallah. Oh, sister, nice to see you again. Develops a bond. The minute you start asking too many questions, sister, what do you weigh? She said, what? That's the last question you ask a woman, man. Subhanallah, what do you weigh? What do I weigh? That's insulting me, man. Allahu Akbar. So be careful of such questions, you know. People want to know you, are you married? You say no, they're your best friend. And the minute you tell them I'm engaged, they no longer talk to you because they wanted you for somebody. That's the attitude. It happens with the men as well. No. Ask good questions. MashaAllah, how are you doing? How's your health? May Allah bless you. Rattle out a few du'as and mean it. Mean it. May Allah bless you. May Allah grant you goodness. You see someone in a wheelchair. You see someone limping. Subhanallah. Make du'a. Make du'a for them. May Allah cure you. May Allah grant you goodness. That's how we will succeed as an ummah. The difficulty with us, let's face it, when there are negativities, we are the first people to beam them across the globe. Gossip. That's what social media has become. If there's something good, it's difficult for us to spread it. But gossip, it's like hot cakes. Hot cakes. Trust me. What happens? We say, ooh, did you hear that? Did you see? Ooh. You know what happened? Ah, we went there tonight. You know what we saw? We saw a couple kissing at the back. Ooh. One couple kissed. The rest of them, what did they do? And that they might have been husband and wife, who knows, having a romantic moment under the moonlight. Allahu Akbar. May Allah forgive us. I'm not encouraging that in public. Obviously, it's something you should know. But all I am saying is, have a good mind, have a clean heart. You don't need to start spreading. Spread the good that was there. As for the bad, like I said, you really want to correct, go and correct the people correctly, in a proper way. Speak to them in a nice way. Develop a link without talking. So the mathematics teacher went to go and seek help from someone. went to talk to them, to complain, basically. The reaction of this person was so brilliant that this woman, after a period of time, decided to change her life. Subhanallah. Not because someone swore her, or someone insulted her, or someone told her, you are going to Jahannam, but because of the good treatment that she had from someone who knew the deen. And the person just respected her. Look, my beloved sister, my dear sister, I tell you that that is not representative of Islam. The true Islam, here is the hadith. The Prophet says, when you want to correct someone, you do it with wisdom. Allah says that.
Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'idati al hasana.
When you are calling to the path of Allah, call with wisdom and with the best way of discussion or debate or engaging the people you are trying to call. Use the best way to engage them. Do not use a terrible way. And the sister was so touched, and after a while, mashallah, everything changed. Do you know what? That man who spoke about her had to come and apologize to her a year later to say, my sister, I'm so sorry. What I said was terrible. It was bad. It was unacceptable. May you forgive me. Without you forgiving me, Allah will not forgive me. And the sister says, it's okay. Perhaps it was the root of what happened after all. Imagine the good heart. But today we doom people. That's the example. You cannot say you're going to Jahannam. That person might get guidance. How do you know? This is why we say, do not judge. Do not judge. There are some of us who have terrible habits. Really ugly habits. But outwardly, we look like saints. May Allah forgive us. Tonight is the night of change. You want to solve the problems of the Muslim Ummah across the whole globe? I tell you, Allah offers you the solution, but the problem with us, we want to solve it our own way. It's like someone saying, when they're 10 years old, I want to become a doctor. So you take them straight to the university and you make them write the final exam. No. It will take them years. They need to go first through primary school, through secondary school, through college. And then they will get to a certain point where they will finally qualify. And after that, there is internship. I'm sure you know what that is. And after that, they will be able to practice and open their own practice after a certain number of years. And even after that, the doctors every year will need to attend so many seminars and so many conventions or workshops in order to maintain their certificate of operation and so on. So many rules and regulations. But what we want to do, we heard 10 years old, you want to become a doctor, we took them straight to write the final exam. The same applies. We know the solutions of the globe, the problems on the globe. Allah says,
إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ.
Allah will not change the condition of a nation, of an ummah, until that particular qawm or nation changes. Every single one of them change themselves. You change, he changes. I change, she changes. We change together, community becomes better. Firstly, you become better. Then your family becomes better. Then your community becomes better. Then your country becomes better. Then the neighboring countries become better. The region becomes better. And then the entire globe becomes better. That is how you will achieve your doctorate, or you become a doctor. For example, it's an effort. I don't want to pray. I don't want to change. I don't want to stop backbiting. I want to speak evil about people. I want to keep on talking about cleaning hearts when I have the dirtiest heart. I want to keep on speaking about making life easy for everyone else when my daughters-in-law, sons-in-law, my children, my family members, they are suffering because of my bad mouth, my bad habits, because of my set ways. I know of some mothers-in-law who just sit back and treat their daughters-in-law like slaves. You're supposed to cook. You're supposed to... Did you hear the one? The one daughter-in-law enters the home, so the mother says, listen, nothing will change in my house. You don't change a thing. Did you hear that? Hey, relax. This woman is somebody's daughter. She's just come into the home. You need to welcome her. Don't talk this way. Anyway, she was one up, mashallah. Nowadays, they're educated, as they say. She says, yes, nothing will change. You can continue doing the cooking and the cleaning, and you can continue doing everything. I will just sit there and I'll just massage your son. Allahu Akbar, mashallah. Nothing will change. Look, you want to give us something, we give you something back. Mashallah. May Allah forgive us. Obviously, please don't do that. You know, you might be kicked out of the house. But the point I'm raising is, why should you be such a horrible person in your house? Make things easy for people. Why do you want to make things difficult for your own children at times? Make things easy for them, good things. Sometimes they are reasonably asking you for something acceptable and you're saying, no, I don't want. Just because you're proud, just because you're arrogant. Stop it. You need to help our brothers suffering in Syria and in Iraq and in Afghanistan and in Pakistan and in Yemen and everywhere else where they are suffering. The beginning is for you to change yourself. That's what Allah says. Allah says, you want to get to that level of certificate of a doctor? Start off now. You're going to have to go through primary, secondary, and then when you've built yourself, automatically, if everyone has the same concern, you'll be able to help the entire ummah. The difficulty with us is we want to solve a problem of occupation in Palestine when our own hearts are occupied by a devil that is even worse. So free yourself first from the clutches of the devil, and then you see how Allah will help you elsewhere across the globe. Some people have told me, oh, you know what? You're talking nonsense. I said, okay, fine. Those who've tried other solutions have failed. And in fact, things are getting worse. You agree? So start trying what the Quran says, and you see what will happen. As we think we're doing whatever comes to our minds and hearts, removing the Quran and the Sunnah from the equation, we're making matters worse. Problems are becoming bigger. But if you were to rectify yourself, correct your own heart, purify it, if you were to try and develop your link with your Maker and step in the right direction, inch forward, even if it means an inch at a time, you will be earning the pleasure of Allah. You will be able to solve the matters in your own homes, in your communities, societies. You will spread the love, not the hate. You will spread peace, not war. You will spread tolerance, not intolerance. That is the theme of what I've said today. My brothers and sisters, let's wake up. Let's stop blaming everyone else for the problems of the ummah. Let's blame ourselves. Let's correct ourselves. I want to be a better person. Don't we all want to be better people? Well, start somewhere. Tonight is a beautiful opportunity. It is a historic opportunity. Tell yourself here and now that I want to change. Oh Allah, the bad habits that I have, I admit them. I regret them. I seek your forgiveness about them. And I will not do them again. I am changing here and now. Each one of us knows our weakness. We know our bad habits. We know the sins that we are addicted to. My brothers and sisters, don't wait for someone else to come to tell you, because they may not come to tell you. You may not see another day. Start your day seeking forgiveness. End your day seeking forgiveness in a way that if you were to die during the day or the night, it would have been a day or a night where you had started it seeking forgiveness of Allah. So my brothers and sisters, what a powerful message. Do you know why it's powerful? Because it's not mine. It comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's something amazing. It is something that touches the heart. It is a cord. The link between you and I is the fact, number one, we are part of the children of Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. We're the children of Adam. I'm related to you. Do you know how? My great, 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 and add a few more greats, grandfather, and your exact same great, great, and a few more great grandfather is exactly the same person. Who was he? Guess who? Guess who? Can I hear it? No, the Prophet Noah. Nuh, may peace be upon him. See, you haven't been listening to the lectures. Subhanallah. The Prophet Noah, may peace be upon him. After the incident of the ark, he was the only one who bore children. Did you know that? So we're all connected to him somehow. Mashallah. Our forefathers, somewhere up the ladder, were in the ark with him. Subhanallah, there were 11 of them, people. One of them was that man whom we are connected through. In fact, to be honest with you, we probably connected even closer than that. But that's something we know yaqeenan, with conviction. So I'm related to you. Yes, I am. I'm part of the family. And I have come to you with a good message by the will of Allah. I don't have time to come to you, dooming you, creating problems in your society. I have a habit. If I have been given the opportunity by Allah to meet a community, I try my best. May Allah forgive me if I faltered. I try my best to come to the community and leave them in a better condition than they were, or at least exactly where they were. The aim is better, but never worse. I will not come to your community and cause a fitna, cause a problem, split you, divide you. No way. That's not what I'm here for. I'm here to bring people together. And you are witness to that. What have I said today? I've asked you to come together. I spoke about the difference between uniformity and unity. Uniformity is when you want people to be exactly like you. That's impossible. But unity is when you tolerate people who differ with you. Subhanallah. Then you're united. I can be united with you. Right now, we are united. Look, we're all here. I'm sure we have differences in so many ways. But mashallah, together we made this function. Together we made this event a success. May Allah accept it from us and gather us in paradise. The same way He's gathered us here today. What an awesome event. May Allah accept it from those who've organized it. This is why, if you notice, when Abdurrahman came to the front here and he said, these people are part of my team. What did I do? And what did Sheikh Musleh do? We got up and walked behind because we are also consider ourselves a part of a team. I would never have been able to been here speaking to you if it wasn't for another 20 to 30 people. It's part of a team. It's teamwork. It would never have been a successful evening without every single one of you. Subhanallah. It wouldn't have been a successful evening. But there is no point in going back and saying, mashallah, the best event we've had. Successful, peaceful. The weather's beautiful. Absolutely awesome weather. Mashallah. In the beautiful country of Guyana here in South America. My first time this part of the world. Alhamdulillah. Not the last, inshallah. If Allah wills, we'll be back again here next year by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why not? But there is no point in saying it was a good talk, a good function, powerful speech. The sheikh delivered, the other sheikh delivered. They spoke very well. It was eloquent. The sound was beautiful. The lighting was excellent. The gathering was absolutely electrifying. But your life didn't change. Nothing happened. They say, but what exactly was said? They say, I don't know, but I know it was powerful. It was powerful. Oh, it was absolutely powerful. What was powerful? Nothing. You forgot. So that's why I tell you, change now. If a speaker is saying, my brothers and sisters, seek the forgiveness of Allah, you know what you're supposed to do? There and then, pause for a moment in your mind, say, oh Allah, forgive me. Who knows, it might just be the moment of acceptance and the angels have written it next to your name and that's it, your life has changed. So my brothers and sisters, we want a life-changing experience. You know the habits you have. You know the sins you've committed. I know mine. I know my weaknesses. You know yours. Here and now, oh Allah, these weaknesses, help me with them. I will make the biggest effort to stop this now. And I want you to help me in that effort and make me strong. Oh Allah, love me. I love you. Oh Allah, save me from the devil. Protect me from shaitan. Keep him away from me and keep me away from him. Oh Allah, whenever I want to do something wrong, create a barrier between me and that wrong in whatever way you feel fit. Subhanallah. But say this. Become in the habit of saying it. Feel it. We need to start. My brothers and sisters, how many of us wouldn't even get up for Salatul Fajr in the morning tomorrow? Will we change that, inshallah? Will we change that, inshallah? Alhamdulillah. May Allah make it happen. Get up in the morning, serve Allah. When you get up early morning and you pray to Allah and you breathe the fresh air at that time, it helps you psychologically, spiritually, emotionally. You feel so good. The problem is we sleep so late. We sleep so late, we don't even know. Subhanallah. The time for Fajr comes in, goes out. The sun rises, we have no clue. And the next best thing, the alarm goes off shamelessly when you're just about to go to work. What about salah? If you were to die on that day, what would happen? You didn't start your day on the right footing. This is why, my brothers and sisters, every morning, start your day seeking the forgiveness of Allah. Start your day with prayer. Start your day with a little bit of recitation of the Quran. Even if it means one verse. How much? One verse. And take its meaning and read the meaning. So you read the Arabic if you can and you read the meaning. If you cannot read the Arabic, start doing something about it, inshallah, and soon you will be able to. But read the meaning of it. If you don't understand, you ask the scholars, what does this mean? I didn't understand this verse. One verse. One verse. Your aim and intention is, inshallah, in 20 years I'll finish the whole Quran. Whoa. It's a long time. But I want to tell you something. Soon you will want to read more than a verse. And in no time you'll finish the Quran, but you need to start somewhere. You need to be dedicated. خَيْرُ الْعَمَلِ مَا دِيمَ عَلَيْهِ وَإِنْ قَلْبِ. The best of deeds are those that are done regularly, even if it's very little. That's what Muhammad, peace be upon him, says. There's no point in me reading one entire Quran, or for 5 hours one day I'm feeling holy, so I start reading. And then suddenly for the next year, I haven't even picked up the Quran. What's that? The Prophet, peace be upon him, says it'd rather be regular. One of the benefits of regularity is, if for some reason, the reason of sickness or illness or forgetfulness, you have not managed to fulfill it one day, the angels write the reward for you as though you were there, because your excuse was valid. That's what it is. And if you were to die halfway through, the reward will have been written as though you completed the entire Quran, because innamal a'malu binniyat, indeed all actions shall be judged based on their intentions, and your intention was to complete the entire Mus'haf, the entire Quran. You didn't, but Allah knows. Like a person who wants to go for Hajj and they happen to die in the way, Allah will give them a reward for the Hajj by the will of Allah. Yes, perhaps someone may want to fulfill it on their behalf as a physical fulfillment because it was not physically fulfilled. But as for a reward, Allah alone knows. This person couldn't have had a better death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. So my brothers and sisters, I started off by speaking about the salam and the greeting. And I want you to know that it is very important for us to reach out to one another. Start with this greeting. The reason why it is compulsory for you to respond to the greeting is when someone has done something so good to you, you need to respond to it with goodness that is equivalent. You know, the hadith says, when a person has done something really good to you, the minimum is you should say, Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah reward you with a good reward. That's what it means. May Allah reward you with a good reward. I may not be able to give you so much, but Allah will give you even more. So when a person makes a prayer for you, for peace and for the blessings of Allah, and for the mercy of Allah, naturally, it's your duty to respond in a beautiful way. It is compulsory to reply. Some of us, wallahi, it has happened with me. I've greeted people, maybe they might belong to a different sect of Muslimin or whatever else it might have been, I don't know. But myself, with a good heart, going around, Assalamu alaikum, my brother, they look at you and say, walk away. Ooh, that face, you spoiled your face. I didn't spoil mine. You know, I learned something from my dad many years ago. He says, if you don't want to age quickly, you need to make sure the expression on your face is not harsh. Wow. Many people, you look at them and they look like this, you know. They scrunch up their eyes and you find these lines at the top here. When we were young, they told us, you count these lines. For every line there is, you're going to live 10 years. Woo. That's all fake. But they scrunch up. So now what happens? These creases begin to show at the age of 35 and 40. And before you know it, your face is scrunched up with all these marks all over the show. Why? Because all day the way you showed your face was like you were negative yourself and you beamed negativity. But I tell you one thing, leave it normal. Smile now and again and you see what happens. I know some of you are saying, gosh, this came a bit too late. But don't worry. It's still there, mashallah. It's still there. By the will of Allah, keep a good face. Look at yourself. You know, when I was young and I used to frown, my father used to put his two fingers here on my eyebrows. And he used to just press it for a little while to remind me, don't do that. When I was very young. And that's how I had this habit of always having a face that's either smiling or normal, but not frowning. I don't think it's easy to see me, you know, with a spoiled face. May Allah forgive me and forgive all of us. Ameen. So this is why we say, the expression on your face is considered an act of worship if it were to be positive. Do you know that? تَبَسُّمُكَ فِي وَجْهِ أَخِيكَ صَدَقَ. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, if you were to smile at the face of your brethren, it is actually an act of worship, an act of charity. Amazing. Why? The reason is, you're beaming positivity. Like I said, people are going through so many difficulties. Life is all about difficulties, matters, issues, challenges. Every one of us goes through so much. The last thing you need is for someone else to add to that. No, I don't.
At least smile. At least talk to me. At least say some good things, nice things. At least for a moment I will be feeling, you know, that I don't have such serious problems, or that we are all part and parcel of one ummah. And alhamdulillah, we are together. Sometimes even if you don't have a problem, just being in the company of the miserable makes you miserable. I promise you. I have a few people like that. I don't like to talk to them much. Salaamu alaikum. Wa alaikum as-salam. And I'm out. Why? Because I feel so stressed when I'm with them. They only complain. That's it. Only complain. What is complaining going to do? If you complain whole day, whole night, it's not going to solve your problem. If that was the case, I would have told all of you, please, my brothers and sisters, don't waste your time listening to me this evening. Let's all go home and start complaining. Put it on Facebook, put it on Twitter, put it on Instagram. Complain to the whole world about all your problems, because once you have 1 million views about your complaint, it will go. Guess what? That's foolish. It will never happen. The more people know about your problem, the bigger the problem becomes. Do you know that? The bigger the problem becomes. So relax. Learn to reach out to others. Allah will reach out to you. كان الله في عون العبد ما كان العبد في عون أخيه. Allah will continue to assist or to be at the help of a worshipper for as long as that worshipper is helping another. How many have you helped? How many do you reach out to? Like I said earlier, when you go, would you like to be a person who goes down in history as someone who made the lives of others difficult, or someone who made the lives of others easy? Ask yourself, what type of a person am I? O son of Adam, when you were born, you came to this world crying, and those around you were smiling in happiness. So live your life in such a way that when you leave, those around you, or when you leave, you will leave smiling, and those around you will be crying at the loss. Wow. That's taken from an Arabic couplet, just translated into the English language. O son of Adam, when you came to the world, you came crying, and those around you were smiling in happiness. So live your life in such a way that when you leave this world, you leave it smiling, and those around you will be crying at the loss. Some of us, when we leave, people will say, oh Allah, you should have taken him 10 years ago. May Allah forgive us. Yeah. Or when we leave, we say, I'm finally gone. Astaghfirullah. Will people really miss us? Will they miss the goodness that we've done? Well, if you think yes they would, then inshallah, you may have been heading in the right direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us all. My brothers and sisters, once again, the world that we see out here and the material items that we have here, that's not the aim. That will not bring about happiness and contentment. No, some of those who have the most are depressed the most sometimes. And some of those who have very little are content. Sometimes you do have people who have a lot, but they know where it stands. They have contentment. And some people who have very little, but they don't know what it stands for, and they are depressed. And sometimes we have what we need, but we don't have what we want. So we become upset with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not realizing that He's given us everything we needed, but He doesn't want to give us some of the things we just want. There is a difference between needs and wants. Sometimes we want things, but they're not good for us. But whatever we need, Allah's already given us. Subhanallah. We're seated here in such peace, such serenity, such goodness. We're seated here with so much of calmness. I'm sure the hearts are softened because the angels are praying for us. That's according to the hadith. Whenever people gather in order to remember Allah, the angels surround them and they pray for them. And Allah mentions them to the angels up there in the heavens, to say, these are my worshippers remembering me, and we will achieve the forgiveness of Allah before we get up from here. Subhanallah. So the situation we are in right now is so blessed. Let us seize the opportunity, my brothers and sisters. Increase this. Let it become a promise and a pledge to Allah, not to me. You promise Allah, oh Allah, make me a better person. I promise you, I'm going to try my best. You know, some people make dua and they keep on making dua. Oh Allah, help me to get up for Salatul Fajr. But they do nothing about it. Oh Allah, help me to be truthful. They do nothing about it. Oh Allah, help me to stay away from the nightclubs. But they go every weekend. Oh Allah, help me to stop gambling. But they still go and gamble. Oh Allah, help me. You know what? If you want Allah to help you, you need to make an effort as well. Allah will come to you for as long as you start coming to Him. Allah says, if you come to me a handspan, I come to you a foot. If you come to me walking, I come to you rushing. But you have to start coming to me, then I come to you. You can't just sit back and say, oh Allah, come to me. Allah says, hang on, you come. You make the first move and see what happens. Subhanallah, I will come quicker than you can imagine. Some people are walking away from Allah, making a dua to Allah to come towards them. How? Still through Allah's mercy, He blesses us with a lot of goodness. So, it's similar to a person who says, oh Allah, I know that sustenance is in your hands. I know that sustenance is in your hands. And I've heard that you have already written whatever's going to come to me. So I'm going to sit at home, and I'm going to relax on my bed, and I'm going to keep on praying to you, and I want you to send all the sustenance that's written for me to my doorstep. So do you know what? Allah says, I didn't write much for you. There's not much for you. Why? You were foolish, that's why. You have to get up and do something about it. You know the hadith says, لَوْ أَنَّكُمْ تَتَوَكَّلُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ حَقَّ تَوَكُّلِهِ لَرَزَقَكُمْ كَمَا يَرْزُقُ الطَّيْرِ. The hadith doesn't end there, but let me translate that much first. If you had the correct conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would sustain you and provide for you the same way He provides for the birds. So some people stop there and say, yeah, well that means I can just sit and do nothing. And like the bird gets whatever it gets, the worms and so on, I will get. But the hadith does not end there. It continues to say, تَغْدُو خِمَاسًا وَتَرُوحُ بِطَانًا. It leaves the nest early in the morning with an empty belly, and it flies around all day and comes back at the end of the day with the belly filled. Allahu Akbar. What does that mean? That means Allah will provide for you in the same way He provides for the bird, on condition that you make an effort and you go to work and you go and look for the job and you come back with the sustenance. That's what it means. You don't just sit back and say, Oh Allah, I want you to send me a job. Like Bill Gates is going to phone you and say, guess what? I just got your phone number from somewhere and we are going to employ you. Come on, man. Subhanallah, how foolish is that? You might want to see me later. We might provide a psychiatrist, inshallah, to get you checked. Astaghfirullah. Yes, you will make dua. And on top of that, subhanallah, you will be a person who makes an effort. Then what comes in your direction is definitely from Allah. So Allah does control sustenance without a doubt. Allah has written what's going to come to you without a doubt. But the beauty is you don't know what He has written. So go out and work. People say, if Allah's already written who's going to Jannah and who's going to Jahannam, what's the point of working? Well, the answer is, you don't know what is written, so start working. How do you know where your name is? You don't know, and that's the whole secret. So that's why you need to work and hope that it is in the right place. Subhanallah. Simple answer. There are more sophisticated answers to that, but I've just given you a simple one. My brothers and sisters, my hour is up. But at the same time, I feel like continuing. This is Guyana. It's not like I come here every so often. Subhanallah. And everyone is seated here, mashallah, tabarakallah. Look at how beautiful it is. He's coming to tell me, carry on. But I don't want to come on, subhanAllah. You've got to have mercy on the people here as well. They probably have pins and needles already. My brothers and sisters, it's actually been awesome to be here. I hope and I pray that you can take one thing from what I said. One, just one. If you have taken one thing from the 20 things I mentioned, we have succeeded. And please pray for me, that Allah grants me guidance and goodness myself. We all want Jannah, we want to go to paradise. And I hope and I pray that we see each other in Jannah, in paradise. We want to see each other. When you see one another, learn to love each other. Learn to make dua for Jannah for people. You will have differences, you might have a few disputes as well. Don't let that lead to hatred. Yes, you want to solve it, you want to resolve it. It might lead to a little bit of feeling in the heart. That's what human nature is all about. But you must try and resolve it, try and extinguish it. You cleanse it for the sake of Allah, Allah will guide you. Allah will provide for you. Like I said, I plan to come again here. But only Allah knows if I will be around, or if I will be available, or if I will be able to even come. So this is why we say, my brothers and sisters, the fact that we've met today is not a coincidence. I always say, مَا أَصَابَكَ لَمْ يَكُلْ لِيُخْطِئَكَ وَمَا أَخْطَأَكَ لَمْ يَكُلْ لِيُصِيبَكَ. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, and this hadith is so vast, the meaning is absolutely broad. He says, what got to you was never meant to miss you, and what missed you was never meant to get to you. This applies to everything. One of the things is speech, a meeting, something that happened. If you heard something, it was meant to get to you. It was never going to miss you. It was going to come to you, your ears, and you will be questioned about it. Allah will ask you, didn't someone come and tell you clean your heart? Didn't someone come and tell you turn towards Allah, start moving forward, start, you know, growing in your link with your maker, and so on. We heard a message just before mine saying, Subhanallah, we need to prepare for the day we die. We need to prepare for the hereafter. Amazing. That is so, so true. It's the one reality that nobody can deny. So this is how, my brothers and sisters, we will be questioned. Similarly, if something missed you, it was never meant to get to you. Someone shoots at you and the bullet zooms past your ear, 1 millimeter away from your ear. Trust me, it was never ever meant to get to you. Never. مَا أَخْطَأَكَ لَمْ يَكُلْ لِيُصِيبَكَ. Whatever missed you was never going to get to you in the first place. But the other side of it, what got to you was never meant to miss you. That is a bit scary. Subhanallah. Why? Because today we met, today we spoke. Allah will ask me, you told these people things. Did you make sure that you were fitting into what you told them, or were you just a hypocrite preaching goodness and being a bad person behind the scenes? That's a question for me. I need to worry about it. And the question for you is, you heard a message. What did you do about it? Did it move you? If it did move you, how long did it move you for? I tell you, if you do nothing about the movement that has happened in your heart tonight, by tomorrow, it will already be halved. 48 hours pass, it's over. The impact will no longer be so powerful that it will make you want to change. Your want to change will only last 48 hours and it will become weaker and weaker as the hours pass. This is why you want to change, change now. Don't leave it for too long. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. Once again, really, I love you for the sake of Allah. That's why I'm here. I don't ask for you anything besides a good dua. I don't ask from you anything besides a good dua, besides a good supplication. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep you united. May Allah keep you as happy as you are and even happier. All those who are struggling and suffering in any way, may Allah alleviate your suffering. Those who are sick and ill, may Allah cure you. Those who've passed away, may Allah have mercy on them. And the day we pass away, may Allah have mercy on us as well. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته